thank you anyway. Thank you for the welcome. Just want to talk a little bit about. I just came back from a BFM business school session where I think a couple of things that we talk about is about strategy, and this is mainly for corporates. But I think it's important to think about strategy as well in the product space, in the business space, for entrepreneurs, right? Because I think there's a lot of strategic thinking that needs to go into before even you, whilst you're thinking about your business, whilst you're thinking about starting it out. Even if you're just a product person, I think there's a lot to think about strategy. Now, strategy encompasses, I spent, I guess, 6 months, at 6 months to a year dealing with strategic issues at a sort of academic level. And actually something like Blue Ocean Strategy is something which came after my business school days, right? So it is a framework. There's a few frameworks out there, but some things don't die. What doesn't die is the fact that you need a strategy for your business and you need a strategy for your product. I think the best way, I think the team at Magic thought I should do this is actually to use a Blue Ocean framework, which is fine. That's one of the strategy frameworks out there. But to also, in a way, apply it to BFM, to the BFM experience. How has that framework helped? How has that framework crystallized things? How does that work, right? So I'd like to put it on the BFM experience. First question first. I appreciate Alan's introduction, but I never assume that everyone knows about BFM. Who has not heard of BFM? Okay, right. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, that's good. I shouldn't assume. So for those who has heard of BFM, just to have the other way around. Okay, all right, good. So I think for those of you who haven't heard of BFM, we are a radio station, but with a slight twist, and the twist is why this Blue Ocean thing comes out. The twist is that we're a business radio station. We focus on business topics. We focus on business issues. There's programs on. We talk to CEOs. We talk to entrepreneurs. We even actually for some of our during our less prime time, we also talk to folks from the arts, folks from on current affairs, and we also do a lot of sort of very vocal conversations about public policy. Right? So that's what BFM is all. In a nutshell, that's what BFM is all about. Started about 6 years ago, 2008. Although the preparation of it was in 2007. We've been around for 6 years. We're doing okay. I mean, I think we hit some benchmarks for entrepreneurs. Is when do you hit? When do you have to put? When the you're not bleeding anymore? We didn't bleed after about 2 years. After that, the revenues coming in paid for the cash, paid for our expenses going out. There's a very big milestone for startups. I can go into that a little bit. All right. So it is a radio station right now. It's in the Klang Valley or Greater KL. The problem is that although we have a national radio license, I think we wanted to go to places like Penang. We wanted to go to other areas, but there's a frequency limitation. That's the official reason. I think we've proven otherwise. There's no frequency limitation, but I think because we're very vocal, I think sometimes this country is a little bit like that. They're like, okay, you better stay in KL with all those guys and don't come and infect anyone else. So there we are. Anyway, so it's about building a blue ocean business and commercializing it. I must say, I'm not sure whether I'm qualified, but I guess I had three startups. I've been involved in three startups so far. Two I founded, one I joined, right? So the one I founded first was KL Classifieds, a now defunct company, simply because I failed at that first venture. It was a classifieds. I'll go into that a little bit in a while. It was a classifieds only paper. It's. I'm not sure whether you're familiar with other markets. There's something called Loot in the UK. There's something called Trading Post in Australia, and something called Buy and Sell in Canada. Essentially, when you have in the old days of pre-internet, you just had a newspaper in the classified section, where we should advertise property, cars, and all that—the kind of things that you have right now, but on the internet. Malay Mail was a number one classifieds paper at the time. So what we did was basically we said, okay, forget the news. We just sell the classified section. So that was in 1997. Next venture, I joined Mark Chang in Job Street because I was in classifieds business anyway. And JobStreet was launching. JobStreet needed someone to, they got the money ready, they just needed someone to write the business plan. So Mark said to me, hey Malek, come join us, let's write the business plan, get the MSA status, let's do a few things with this company. So I joined JobStreet at the time. And then now in about 8 years later, I founded another company, which is this radio station, you know, back to traditional media again. But I'll tell you why my heart is on the internet. There's one big reason for that, but let me come back to it. Let me just say it now. I was in Boston, Cambridge, Massachusetts area in the years 1993 to 1995. That was the birth, really, of the dot-com days, right? So I was just I was studying at the time. I remember typing. Have you ever typed this words before on your website? Jerry and David's Guide to the World Wide Web .com, www.jerryand... you've never done that, right? You've always typed at least Yahoo, right? So those were the days. Sorry, you okay? Those were the days when we had to type that to get a website, and it took... It was just a listing of websites, right? So those were the very, very early days. And there was one guy who never attended class. I was in business school at the time. There's one guy who I'm supposed to have class with and all that. I always hear his name, but when there's a roll call, you know, he's never around. His name was Tim Brady, right? And Tim Brady is employee number 3 at Yahoo. He wrote the business plan, kind of like me at JobStreet at the time, you know, writing business plan. We're good for writing business plans, you know, people like me, right? This great plans. Tim Brady was one of them. He became head of products for Yahoo. I think he was there for about 12 years, I think, after that. Later, I found out there are a few other people who did a few things. One of my classmates, now this is truly, I know this person, Hope Chang and Will Chen. They actually started up a company called Billpoint. I'm from that generation that started this dot-com web 1.0, right? They started Billpoint, they sold Billpoint to eBay within about 8 months of starting a company. Those were the go-go days. Billpoint really got, Billpoint actually is a competitor to PayPal. At the end of the day, eBay bought Billpoint, couldn't integrate it. In the end, eBay just bought PayPal. So you had the speaker previous before me talking about PayPal. This was in the early days, all the genesis of this happening. Later, I found out, you know, looking at Facebook, you know, Facebook, this is weird, I mean, you know, not that I know these guys really well. I know Will and Hope really well, but there's another story, which is just to explain a little bit about why my interest in the internet is so high. One time looking, hey, Facebook has just employed a new CEO, right? And now this CEO is considered the adult in the company, right? The adult in the company. And that CEO happens to be Sheryl Sandberg, right? And Sheryl Sandberg, I don't know her, but we're in a class of 900 people. She's one of them, right? So she was in my year at business school. So out of 900 people, Sheryl Sandberg was one of them. I'm like, so I tried to call her and say, hey, please, can we interview you? And her PA replied, sorry, cannot be interviewed. So, okay, classmate like that, lah. No, you CEO won't be interviewed by BFM. Never mind, it's okay. I'll see her in the next reunion. I'll just call her out on that one. See what happens. But that's my interest in the internet. But funny enough, I find myself back in traditional media. I don't know why. Let's see. And I think, but there is a theme, and the theme is this. Let me come. Blue ocean. What's the theme? The theme is, who knows blue ocean, red ocean concept? It's a very popular concept. I'm judging some Entrepreneur of the Year awards right now, and these are public company CEOs and all that. And the word blue ocean comes back again and again. Who hasn't heard of blue ocean, red ocean? Okay, all right. So again, never assume. So the idea of, it was popularized by an INSEAD professor who says that as the following, you know, most competition, most businesses that you know today are red ocean. Why? Why is it called red ocean? It's because it's bloody. Why is it bloody? Because people are fighting, companies are fighting all the time for the same customers, same employees, same competitive advantages, right? So what are the kind of things that happens? Basically, it's known markets, you know, say for example, your retail, your FMB, you're fighting, Old Town's fighting, Papa Rich is fighting, whoever. Banks, RHB Bank's fighting, CIMB fighting, Maybank fighting, you know, Hong Leong Bank, etc. Known markets. Another thing is, it's contested markets. You're not there alone. You're there with, you know, a bunch of other competitors. Yeah? Telco, Maxis, DG, you know, U-Mobile, Cellcom, Axiata, etc., etc. And And also, there's also some, the Red Ocean's also bloody because, I mean, bloody, that's the reason, competition is bloody. But the other thing is because it's also, there's established rules of competition. You fight on price, you fight on customer intimacy, you fight on differentiation, you fight on these various areas, right? Or customer service, etc. So there are known rules of competition. And what this INSEAD professor says, and this was only 2005, so I'm back applying this to the ventures that I've done. But when in 2000, he said, well, what, there are companies out there that don't do this stuff, that are in places where, oops, format has run, there's undiscovered markets. You are not in the business of competing for existing demand. You are actually in the business of creating demand, right? And there's no competition yet. Sure, there'll be competition that come at some point in time. And then, but the rules of competition are not yet set. People don't even know what the rules are. You know, what's the rules for competition for Instagram right now? I don't know. You know, it's just right now it seems like it's the best user interface. You know, it's the fastest user, easiest to load interface. Are those the rules of competition or what have you? So there's this element of red ocean with bloody. So basically, you're moving from contested space, but also thinking out of that, you know, rigidity and all that, and just saying, okay, think about the blue ocean. That means you're swimming. This is a nice sound, is it? You're swimming into the sunset, into the blue ocean, right? So that's the idea. The idea is you go to uncharted waters. So, let me ask you, what I know we do have a lot of red ocean examples. What in your mind are blue ocean examples in the last, say? Yeah, it doesn't matter, in the realm, in the time of history, from day one to whatever. What is blue ocean? What are blue ocean industries that you've seen? Facebook, right? Facebook is blue ocean. Before that, again, another classmate of mine had something called Planet All, which was bought by Amazon in 1997. He had an email version of Facebook, right? Interestingly, right? So he was playing in that space, but the horizon was at the time just email because the web was so slow at the time. So Facebook, it is. So what is the rules of competition in Facebook? Right? It's still being developed, right? You know, when you have Elo and you know Facebook fighting now, what are the rules of competition? Any other examples? Sorry, Waze. Yeah, Waze. So you had that as well. So Waze combines. You know, you had GPS systems, etc., which goes in cars. Now you have something which is, you know, GPS systems cannot crowdsource traffic reports, right? GPS systems go to a central traffic center and gets maybe the input from that. But what Waze does is actually crowdsources information. Just it has the maps and everything, all those things, but it also crowdsources information about your information, what you input, now, all the thousands of people driving to Magic and typing Kirkby International College, whatever it is, right? So they input all that information. That's right. So, but there are other, I guess, there are other examples, and I think these are. And this is a question of degree. To what degree do you say it must be a completely new business model, or is it a completely new product? I think a lot of what we're talking about is products, but businesses. Any examples of businesses? I mean, I guess Facebook is a huge business. I'm not sure. Any other? Amazon, eBay. Yep. Okay. Let me take the eBay example. In the eBay example, I remembered, I did the classifieds business, so basically, you know, doing classifieds, well, we were going to go into the internet classifieds. There was a site called classifieds2000, right, .com at the time, which was a classifieds. Then you have Craigslist, etc. But eBay did something very, very, that was really interesting. They're actually essentially a classified site, but they have this auction component that spiced it up so much that auction component became, it excited people, brought it in, and it became almost a supercharged Craigslist, right? I mean, you don't trade properties on it, you buy knickknacks and things like that, but at the end of the day, actually, the classifieds, whole online classifieds market got accelerated by something like eBay. And then classifieds, all the verticals later catch up, people like Property Guru, etc., you know, realestate.com in Australia, et cetera, right? Those things came later. What eBay went first, right? So I think that was a secret sauce, and it came almost accidentally. It felt like it came almost accidentally. So generally, to contrast the two, red ocean is, when you're fighting the red ocean space, you're just trying to do something better, right? Faster or cheaper, right? That's the rules of competition, really, in a red ocean space, right? So Maxis will try to give you something cheaper. They'll say, oh, we'll give you better, no less drop calls, you know, better internet service, faster internet service, and so on. So it's all that red space that's happening. And then competition will be around that. Blue Ocean will say, it's a different product altogether. There's Waze, there's eBay, and the examples that you gave, Facebook is a different product altogether, and in certain cases, it's a completely different business altogether. So I think that's the interesting part, right? That's fundamentally the idea of a blue ocean strategy, is that you don't have these constraints and so on. It can be misused, though. It can be misused in the sense of like, oh, let's just think of something just far out, right? And so on. But I think, you know, and I see a lot of sometimes marketing campaigns are sold as, oh, this is a blue ocean marketing campaign. It's a misuse of the word, you know, because if you're just fighting for marketing campaign, you're fighting for market share, you're actually still in a red ocean, right? So I was in a bit of dilemma, right? I mean, when I looked at this, I thought, okay, I'm asked to talk about this blue ocean strategy and how it applies to BFM. Is BFM really a blue ocean thing? What do you think? Yes? I'm not as categorical as you. I'm not so sure, right? But let's run with it. Let's see whether it fits into that space. Are we a different product? Are we a different business, right? So, but before we get there, talk about Blue Ocean. Again, I come back to this point. The point is about strategy. At the end of the day, you do need strategy before whatever. You might have a product, but somewhere that product needs a product strategy. I heard Cheryl and Noah just now talk about product management. That product needs to figure out what's your end direction, what's your product roadmap. You know, are you a one-trick show? Are you whatever it is? You need that element. And strategy is about choice. You know, it's a choice. Do I do this or do I do that? And it's about, you know, it's really about sort of, if you don't have a strategy, you do 1,001 different things. Your resources are diluted. Your time is diluted, and you're not choosing. You're not making the hard decision. I'm going to focus on this. I'm going to focus on that. So those are the hard decisions that you need to make, right? So, KL Classifieds, I guess, you know, as I said, Blue Ocean Strategy only started in 2005, but I'm just applying this retrospectively, right? So in my area, when we're doing KL Classifieds, when we're doing this Classifieds only paper, we were changing the business model. I thought this is probably, KL Classifieds was probably the one of the, if you wanted to say something radical, that was actually very, very radical. Can you imagine if you take out, what newspapers consist of? What are your costs consist of? Print, paper, and one of the most expensive costs of newspapers is reporters, journalists, right? They're the most expensive, one of the most expensive part after the paper, right? But where do we get revenues from? Their revenues come from classifieds in those days, right? This was about 15 years ago, now no more. But imagine you split that business into two, right? Where you don't have the cost of the journalists, but you have the revenues of the classified section. Isn't that radical? Is that fun? It seemed fun at the time. I mean, it seemed radical at the time. I enjoyed that. I enjoyed the fact that, you know, the newspapers were going, gee, you know, this guy's eating our lunch and he doesn't have our cost, right? So that's in a way, I think that came close to having a very, very different business. Unfortunately, I'm first to admit, sorry, the normal competition newspaper, I'm the first to admit I was a very inexperienced entrepreneur at the time. And I'll tell you why. I'll show you some mistakes that I've made. I'm an inexperienced entrepreneur. There's also something called the Asian financial crisis, which really put paid, you know, no properties were sold during that time, no cars were sold during that time. So that put paid to that business. Okay, JobStreet. I joined, JobStreet started in 1995. In 1997, Dell came out, Mark started it, started the business as building websites. You know, everyone was building websites in 1995. That's the first thing. But interestingly, in 1997, Dell and Intel said to Mark in Penang, he said, Mark, actually, I don't want you to, if you can just build me a specific website. What's that specific website? It just means build a specific website that can get engineers in the US, Malaysian engineers in the US, to come and see our job postings and come to work for us in Intel, in Dell, in Malaysia. That was the request. And with that came the insight to create JobStreet. This was the first thing that really stuck to the wall when it came to the kind of things that Mark was offering to the Mark was offering to the public, right? Offering to companies. This was the one that stuck. Right? Basically, and he picked up on that. He really picked up on that and said, "Oh gosh, this is something which is interesting." Incorporated a name, got the name Job Street, etc. And then now, where is Job Street now? $1.5 billion drink company and increasing in price at the moment in time, as I know it. So, it was a job portal, online recruitment. It was, in a way, you're not playing in the space of the newspapers, right? The newspapers were the recruitment in those days. That wasn't very that long ago. When you want to look for a great job as a corporate guy or even as a fresh grad, whatever it is, you go to the newspaper and you look up. Depending, you go to Straits Times, you want the manager job. You go to Malay Mail if you want the waiter job, and you go to something like the Star if you want to the sort of entry level jobs and things like that, or white collar jobs. So you have this different positioning of different newspapers with the jobs, right? So that's completely again blue ocean space, which is online recruitment. And wow, you think there's no competition? There was a lot of competition, right? Because there was Monster out in the US, and everyone saw the model very easily. People thought it was easily replicable. A lot of people entered the market. So, BFM, is it a blue ocean thing? As I said, I have my reservations, but I just put it out to you. In one sense, it is. It's a different product. It's targeted towards. It's not talk content. I mean, sorry. It's not music content. It's not entertainment. So in that aspect, it is a different product. Is it radical? Are our revenues generated completely differently from the way other radio stations are? Well, 50% of our revenues are generated differently. So that's interesting. So I feel that sometimes it's an academic question. It doesn't matter. It's a business, right? But there is a business radio station. It's in competition with other music radio stations. We have talk content, right? So that's the differentiation. Whether it qualifies in this professor's words or being a blue ocean thing, I'm not so sure. I'm quite happy to at least, at the very least, it's a complete differentiation, right, in terms of product. If someone wants to call it blue ocean, fantastic. No problems at all, right? So these are the three areas. If you thought that it could be a blue ocean strategy, this is actually a slide that I use for investors to explain the radio space as of 2007, right? This was a slide I brought around, At the time, we didn't have a BFM logo and all that kind of thing. So you had, I kind of categorize this as English, Malay, Chinese, Indian mix, age groups, 12, 25, 35, 45, blah, blah, kind of thing, right? So I said, okay, Hits, Fly FM, X, there was something called X Fresh, now disbanded, Hot FM, My FM, they play in that 12 to 25 space. And then when you get to 25 to 35 space, there's mix, red, there's also THR, THR in the Indian space, etc. And then you move on to 35 to 45, then you get Sinar, there's something called Radio 24, and then above 45, then you get IKIM and Light. Someone said to me, I'm not ready to go from mix to light yet, because when I go to light, I feel like I'm going to die the next day. So I'm like, okay, so there has to be a gap between mix and light, right? So when I was doing this, I definitely, in my mind, thought, this was not a blue ocean game. This is definitely, basically fitting where the current market scenario is, right? So the idea is that a key point here is that differentiation is key. Malaysia wants to move up the value-added chain. We hear about the government offices talking about, it's a fair thing. We are a middle-income country. We need to get to high value, etc. The only way you get to high value, the only way to get to high value is differentiation. I have plenty. My favorite hobby when I go traveling is going to supermarket shelves and taking a picture of things that we produce in Malaysia, but packaged and created and packaged differently, positioned differently, earns 10 times the amount that what we earn for our products here. Yeah, so sesame seed crackers, our sesame seed nuts thing, we come with big packs for 20, it was for $1, right? Big packs for 20. You go to Nature Valley, pop one pack, right? It's $3 Singapore, right? So it's about 7 ringgit. So you get 7 times the price for 1/20th of the product, right? So that's amazing. That's how you get to a high-income country. Differentiation is key. Blue ocean is key, right? So there we are. Again, in radio, the differentiation between red ocean, music, entertainment, there's 30 plus stations. You can play in that space. There's a couple new stations coming up. A couple new stations called PMI, UFM, what else is it? One is a government-sponsored, I guess. Well, they had some money from government. 1M4U, radio station. So they all go into that space. Everyone comes in and says, hey, let's do music, because they think that's the thing, right? So so a lot of people play in that space. I'd rather play in the blue ocean, maybe, what's mixed between blue and red? What color do you get if you mix the two? I don't know. But blue ocean area, so it's talk things.
And that is interesting. I think, this station is actually more differentiated than BFM, which is IKIM. Yeah, IKIM is a station that discusses Islam and Islamic issues. And they have 700,000 listeners, right? Which is double that of BFM. I think, wow, that's really interesting, right? It's really, they have a station, and you have this in the States, you have a lot of the Christian radio stations, right? So completely differentiated. And then you have women station called Capital, women are the new Capital, etc. Women here, how many of you listen to Capital Radio? I said women, but it's okay, it's a guy you listen to, good. It's okay, it's good. You learn about, what women think, etc. Kind of thing. So, yeah, sorry. You might not be listening. I was just asking about the women's station. I think, yeah. It's like when I was a kid, I used to read Cosmopolitan magazine, right? Especially the quizzes, right? And see whether I fulfilled someone's, sort of criteria. There you go. So, that's the strategy part. I'm not going to talk about strategy anymore. What I'm saying is, you got to figure it out, guys. You got to figure out if you're going to an area which is really, really crowded. And I know Keegan is here. I keep talking to Keegan from Activity. He built our iPhone app, right? I said to Keegan, you're operating in that sort of mobile app developer space. I always want Keegan to graduate into, instead of building mobile apps for other people, I want him to build a killer mobile app for himself, for his company, for him to. He has the capabilities. He and his partner Jason has the capabilities to become, the great app developers.
So that's the thing. Would you want to play in that very busy space, or do you want to play in that very, very that empty space? I always have a preference to play in that empty space. So I hope you take that away as one part of it. Now, I'll come to the second part of things. That's the first part. Strategy, easy. You know what? But guess what? Entrepreneurial success in this school of hard knocks, it's 10%. It's 10% inspiration. That's the strategy part, inspiration, and you figure out what markets you want to be, etc., etc., etc. But you know the saying, I don't have to say. It's also 90% perspiration. There's a reason why they call it sweat equity, right? Because you really sweat. And I think that you can't run away from that. Everyone put their time in to sweat. Mark put his time in, I put my time in, with BFM Radio, I put my time in, a lot of people put their time in and do that. Why? Why do you have to sweat? Okay, components of perspiration. What do you have to sweat? Now, okay, this is not a, I used to do an entrepreneurial course on writing business plans. There's basically a five-day program that covers. I think you're doing this as well, which is quite good. I think there was a five-day program that we did at BFM for entrepreneurs, right? And this is everything collapsed into 20 minutes, right? So, and in no particular real order. Let's see. These are the areas. Components of preparation, you have to talk about product. Today is all about product day. Then you have to talk about awareness. And I guess in a way, tomorrow the session's on marketing. And marketing is partly to do with awareness, but it has also to do with product, actually. And marketing has something to do with distribution as well. So that's distribution and sales. Marketing generates sales, right? So you create a demand for your product. And then there's the money part, which also you have a session as well. So but what I'm trying to do here is just say, okay, I'll look at one of these things. Tomorrow, you'll in the future days, you'll see some of these elements. What I'm going to give to you is just the school of hard knocks. The school of hard knocks is basically one business down out of three ventures done, one business koyak, second business went fantastically well. I think that Mark, I was just part of the early team members. I'm not part of the current team who've done fantastically well in making JobStreet what it is. And the third, but the third one, BFM, is that is something I founded again with a group of bunch. But this is a school of hard knocks that what we've learned, what I've learned. Product. Something that don't expect your product to fly off the shelves immediately, or fly off, or people to download your app immediately. Right? They won't. The expectation is they won't. Right? You're not going to be the next. You have to be so lucky to become the next Flappy Bird guy, whatever it is. Right? It's not. You have to. It's like one. Literally, it could be one in a million. Yeah. That's kind of like odds that you have. How many apps are there on? How many game apps are there on Android and and App Store? That's the kind of thing. You're one of them. So it's much later adoption rate than you think. So if you're relying on revenues immediately, you have to, and this comes to the next thing. In a connected world, Facebook, social media, et cetera, I've come to believe, and maybe my opinions might change, but over the last 3-4 years, what I've seen is that marketers always talk to you about the 4 Ps, pricing, your promotions, your advertising, your product, and your pipeline. Pipeline is distribution. But what I'm really seeing is that product is becoming the king of the Ps. They are becoming the main important the main thing, right? And that's what happens, right? Flappy Bird is just product, right? I mean, distribution channels are there already. You put it on App Store. So you don't have to worry too much about distribution. It's there. It's already there. What you need is you need that product, right? And maybe something. This is a necessary condition. Economists have a word of necessary and sufficient condition. It's a necessary condition. Your product must be the best or the most, whatever, right? Tough, not easy. Awareness about advertising or raising the awareness of your product. I used to think that, when KL Classifieds launched, we put 70% of your marketing budget into that and then expect the orders to come in or whatever, the papers to fly off the shelves. Job Street, the same thing as well. Our first venture capital, $2 million, came in from $2 million Sing dollars, actually. So it was $5 million ringgit come in. Bang, we spent $3 million on marketing immediately, right? And expected that. So it came. So the demand came, but for 6 weeks. What do you do for the rest of the year? quick phone off the shelves. Yeah, 6 weeks. And then quiet. And then the website, Mark is a real... He was the first boss I had who literally measured me minute by minute. Malek, you're at work, not working at not working at 2 o'clock, not working at 3 o'clock, or working a bit at 4 o'clock, working a bit at 5 o'clock. But after 6 weeks, it dies, right? So, I must admit, for those of you who didn't know, I almost personally bankrupted Job Street, being a marketing VP of Job Street in those days, right? Seriously, we were spending money we did not have, right? So, and when our CFO came, Greg Porch came, he says, "You guys misrepresented the state of the county before I joined," right? So it's true. That's what we did. So it's a sprint. It's not a sprint. It's a marathon. You need to have some. Yes, you do need some money for launch, and you need some money for this. But then you need to really conserve and make sure that you spend, but not all at once. Yeah, just you have to plan, and I can talk a little bit about that for spending through. The period, a year, 2 years, at least 2 years. Distribution. Depending, right? I think the skew of this audience. Let me ask again. How many of you are in the either mobile or internet space right now? Okay. How many of you are in the what we call the traditional brick and mortar space right now? Okay, so more skewed towards apps, more skewed towards mobile internet, more skewed towards websites, more skewed about this digital products. Fine. But in that area, distribution has become less important, but never underestimated, especially if you're in that brick and mortar world, right? Maxis and Asiata, Salcom and those guys, they fight it out not at, you have these great marketing campaigns, right? Da, 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 all the billboards come out, but actually where they truly fight is at that retail store, and not their retail store, it's someone else's retail store, and they're offering the different SIM cards to you. Those are the guys that influences your decision, right? And you know, when you say, oh, this is, looks like a digi shop, it's not a digi shop, it's dimiliki oleh someone else, right? And that was a fight to get that distributor to sell your product exclusively. Everything is fought on the distribution level, particularly if it's a brick and mortar product, right? I see a lot of entrepreneurs who are trying to put out consumer goods out there, suntan lotion, food products, artisan food products. I judge at a number of competitions, and you know the biggest, toughest thing for them is distribution. For KL Classifieds, I did not do that well, and suddenly I got the what I call the Selangor News Vendors Association Mafia, which is basically members of the MIC coming over me, rings and all that, going, Mr. Ali, you did not ask me permission before you launch your product, huh? I need to ask you permission, huh? Yes, yeah. Mr. Mutu, tell Mr. Malek here, what happens to people who do not ask me permission? Okay. No, it's serious. I mean, seriously, these were knuckle dusters guys, right? They're like rings everywhere and like, you know. Scary people. There's an underworld in KL that you don't know about, as we found out during the bomb that happened. There's an underworld that's happening, and I really, as a fresh entrepreneur, I was a bit like, wow, I never knew KL was like that. So, sales. Plan for zero revenues, guys, for a while. BFM had zero revenues for about 8 months, but that was a thing. KL Classifieds had zero revenues for that, and I mean, zero, I guess we had only like piddly, nothing, but essentially, you know, we had zero revenues for 18 months. In fact, we had zero revenues forever for KL Classifieds. So what does that mean? That means you need some money, and you have an investor session later, yeah? And you need to invest a session. So, fine, I think this world that, you know, you are, when you're working on your own sweat equity, that's fine. But when you start to become a little bit bigger, you have to pay salaries, you have to pay, start, you know, unless you're a group of founders, etc. But if you do raise money, think about the following things. You're probably asked to do a business plan, so you do a business plan. But when you're a business plan, you need to ask for a couple of things. You know, you do your conservative sales, right? And then you halve it, right? And then you say, you put your conservative costs, right? Of what not conservative, you put, you know, sort of, you put, you pad in your cost, you know, it's fairly aggressive cost, and then you double it, all right? And then you project when money is coming in, especially if it's from a business customer, not a consumer customer, a business customer, not app type customer, you double the time that you get paid, right? And then when you sum up this number, you'll find that you probably need about anywhere between 5 to 10 times that what you actually need, right? You need 5 to 10 times of what you projected that you need. So this is the formula that I use for every single startup that I did, right? Basically, I just kind of like said, okay, I did this for the dropship business plan. I said, okay, revenues are like this. The costs are like this. But then basically, but at the end of the day, you plan for the fact that you might put all this rosy forecast, but at the end of the day, you must plan for the fact that, you know, you need enough money to sustain yourself for at least a couple of years, and with this sort of, you know, with a lot of, downside projections like this, right? You halve your sales, you double your costs, you mark up your costs by at least, you double your costs, and then you double the time you eventually paid. Then that's the true sum number. People, and this is the biggest thing for me. I've been through enough, I guess, corporate as well as entrepreneurial side, is that, you know, people is the lifeblood of your, I mean, literally, it's not, people glib about it. Yeah, people are our best, best human capital, da 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 da. All I'm saying is, you will come a time when you will fight. You will have conflicts, right? It's unavoidable. Don't let it fester. Bring it out, right? Don't be stoic about it, so it'll resolve itself. Don't. Nip it in the bud. Surface it out, right? Very hard for Asians, right? We tend to keep inside, and then we blow out and we leave the company. I had that at BFM Radio, right? I had one town hall meeting. This is a town hall, right? American style town hall. And then this presenter said, "You are treating me like a lab rat. I'm leaving right now." Bump out. Like, okay. So because I let it fester, right? I let it fester. Deal with it as soon as possible. Deal with it. Surface it. I have this running thing. I've never seen any condo association or any golf club or a golf club management committee and all that that doesn't fight. Our politicians fight. Our condo association fight. Our golf clubs fight. You know, golf clubs, whatever clubs, right? We all fight because we haven't been taught the thought of dispute resolution. We haven't been taught, literally, you know, I disagree with you, but for now, it's okay. Let's run with what your idea, because I think, you know, everyone here thinks that it's probably the best thing. Let's run with it. These are the milestones. If we don't do these milestones, can we revert back to this idea, right? I've seen Americans do that a lot, right? They kind of like resolve it, kind of a little bit. Like, we do that. I disagree, but I put my reservation here, but never mind, let's go along with what you have at the moment until da da da. Ours is more like, I disagree. And then, kachi ati, you know, gumble. And then, you know, you go for a conference meeting, you know, you have a meeting, everyone's sound seems okay, yeah, okay, again. And then outside, in the smoking, oh, this guy, he doesn't know what he's doing. Been through it all, guys. I've been through it all. So don't worry about it. So deal with it. Conflict's unavoidable. The best way to do is, again, you know, if you have some empirical evidence, that's probably the best. Right? Data is great. If you don't have data, then you have to do some of this conflict resolution stuff. This is the other thing. It's very biblical, this one. Do unto others what you want others to do unto you. Right? I'm not sure it's a reference to, but certainly a lot of people say that. I remember Cosmopolitan magazine, I always, do unto others, you know, what you want others to do. Sorry, it doesn't work. It really doesn't work. It doesn't work with my wife. No, I mean, it doesn't work with my team, right? We're different people. We're very different people. We've just had a session at BFM Business School, listing out the different personality types, right? Some are warm, warm people, emotional. The feelings of the team is very important. You know, they come in place, they have a feel about how people feel. Some are a little bit more sort of, we are goals-oriented with this, we need to achieve this, da-da-da-da-da, less emotion. Others are like conceptual and like always 21 ideas a minute, you know, kind of thing. And then another one's like, the first thing they say, you know, they're very good processes and things like that, what step by step by step, but you bring them to an ideas meeting, the first thing they say is, how? How do we do this? How do we do this? They're like, no, we're just brainstorming. No, how? How do we do this? So we're all very different people, right? So we have this different personality types, right? So I'm very careful. People, you just got to think about these sort of things. And I think there are a lot of, I think to do something like this, really, I don't think it's something that you can read and all that. I think you have to go through it. If you want to accelerate the process, I can recommend you a couple of folks who actually have figured this out, right? And I think for Malaysia, we are very high up on the, you know, yes, sir. When someone says to us, you know, jump, you say how high, right? We're the highest in the world under something called the Hofstede Index. That means we respect authority, perhaps too much. In this survey, so that's our thing. So that does not work. Okay, culture. Hard to say. I think if you're not mistaken, you have this as well. So I think this magic got all the bases covered, so I'm just giving you a bit of preliminary. Culture. Try set this earlier rather than later, right? So what cultures do you want? You want out of your organization, right? Do you want do you want autonomy? Everyone wants autonomy, but within what parameters? You know, the kind of thing. How are you gonna create that appreciation of employees? How are you gonna deal with non-performing individuals or individuals you do think are not performing? There's one company that was said, like, you know, we do not criticize other employees unless they are present in front of us, right? So that means if you want to criticize, you have to criticize in front of them, right? So some companies have that culture, which is great, right? I really am for the cultures that have come out of Silicon Valley. I think I enjoy them. I enjoy the Silicon Valley culture where you work in teams, small teams of 4 to 5 people or whatever it is, right? I think I heard Cheryl saying, you know, the teams, you must be able to share 2 pizzas, right? I love that culture. It's very open. I don't have an office. It's very open plan. Keegan's been to my office. And it's open plan, it's open, you know, it's just people come in and come in and out. I really enjoy that. But maybe a culture might be different from others. You need some quiet time, etc., that kind of thing. So whatever, right? But it has to be, you have to set it earlier rather than later. So this is one of our cultures. We have this gong, a traditional Malaysian, Malay gong, I think, which we ring every time we do sales, right? When we hit a sale, someone signs a sales order, dong, we go, right? So that's what we do as part of our culture. another part of our culture is that, you know, we just, you know, sometimes we do, even though we're a business radio station, we do let our hair down sometimes. And Halloween's coming up, so this was last year's Halloween, right? So we just had a little bit of fun. We have a lot of food as part of our culture. We have these pantries, these two big, I really dream of an island kitchen in my, I told you, I read this Cosmo magazines, man. I love these island kitchens. I love big kitchens, but my house is too small for it. So I put it in the office. I put two in the office. Right? So two kitchen islands, and we all put plow our food on that. And we had a lot of fun, a lot of conversations, a lot of work actually, a lot of thinking goes goes around the conversations and on the island tables. So the other part is business plan. Writing something is different from just thinking it, right? And when you write something, you can communicate. It's a communication tool, but the biggest thing is that it clarifies your own thinking, right? So just for fun, right? When I heard JobStreet was going to be sold to Seek, the deal is still being completed. I pulled out the old business plan, right? And I looked at what we were going to do, right, in the business plan. And the business plan had a product plan. The product plan was jobs first. We do jobs. After that, we go into property. We do a property portal. And then we go into a car portal, right? This very, very step approach, etc. And I looked at it, I think, you know what, interestingly, you know, yeah, I think so JobStreet did a great job in focusing on jobs. But guess what? We had the thought about doing, you know, the iProperties of the world and things like that in year 1999, right? So, but those guys were the first to execute it. Well done. Good. You know, that's your thing, right? So now you have Property Guru, you have iProperty, you know, et cetera, but, you know, but having that business plan actually clarifies your thinking. What are the next areas to go to? So if I remember Suresh, who's the CEO of JobStreet, said to me, Malek, if you don't do radio station, let's rekindle this property idea and let's do a property portal. This was year 2006. Right? So imagine if we did that, right? It would be a completely different ballgame for me, right? We'd be competing against iProperty, competing as Property Guru, right? As opposed to doing radio. But we can just immediately do it because it's part of the plan. We clarified our thinking then. So that's pretty much it. So one part, strategy, blue ocean. Think about doing, it's better to play in a space where there's uncontested. One of the strategies, but at the very least differentiate. And then after that, that's only 10% of your thing. The rest, 90%, is all the other things. Right. The perspiration part, sweat part. You have, all right, so you've got 10 minutes. I'm free for any questions. It's been a long day, I know, but over to you. You can clap later. It's okay.
Sorry for stopping the clap, sir.
No. There weren't many anyway, so it's okay.
Yeah, so I have a question regarding about the company cultures.
Yeah.
So, of course, you have mentioned that you like about the Silicon Valley cultures. Yeah. So, and do you think that the Silicon Valley culture doesn't really work in the Malaysia's, for example, like the flexi hours and et cetera, things like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's my question.
Yeah, what did the first thing that Marissa Meyer did when she went back to Yahoo, right? She stopped flexi hours. She kind of like said, everyone to office. So you're right. There are some elements that you have to, and we think you have to try and see whether how it works or not. So the flexi hour thing, yeah. So some of the areas, I think I like to think. It's still untested, unverified. I like to think that human beings are the same everywhere, and with the right, if people know what they're accountable for, etc., you should be able to do that. Now, in practice, you might have to do it step by step, right? So, for now, at BFM, I keep saying I want to staff up BFM so that everyone can have out of the 5 days that they work. Everyone can have one day where they can do a radio program of their own choosing, right? That's your 20% time. I like to staff up to be able to do that. And I think right now we're at the point where we're staffing up so that actually if people put their minds to it, they can create that 20% time for themselves, right? Um, we the number of programs that we did when we were 36 people, right now we're 54 people. I think our ideal number is probably 48. So we have 6 people around that allows perhaps for that 20% time. Some take advantage of it, some don't, right? Some just still, you know, but then it's okay, right? Then you know, all right, this is working for some people and not working for others. I think at the end of the day, you'll find out that it works for some and doesn't work for others. So at the end of the day, then you have to make a call, all right? And then the one who it works for, and it kind of say, and they do that, they kind of like come back to you and say, you know what? These guys are not working. Yeah, I am working. I'm gonna do it. These guys are just, yeah. And then you have to deal with that kind of issue, right? How do you deal with this unequal thing, right? Some people are thinking the danger is that, you know, those who are not, you know, it infects so that everyone becomes like, okay, let's blow this time off, right? Doing something else.
The radio part, I think, is, yeah, blue ocean because business, and is I don't heard much stations like that.
Yeah.
But what is the motivation doing this events and then this business school? This is not so much.
It's not radio, yeah. Right?
Yeah, it's not radio.
It's not radio, right? So again, so this is a strategic question, right? What does BFM want to get involved with, right? And the idea is, radio is just a platform. It's just another platform. But what are we in the business of? Actually, fundamentally, we're in the business of exposure. We're in the business of education. Educating by exposing people to ideas, to entrepreneurs, to people, to business people, to thought leaders. So the idea actually is not media. The idea is exposure to ideas and thoughts. So that means, okay, radio is one of them. So you listen to our programs in all generally about 20 minutes long, 20-minute interviews. But we have a business school that then has a more of a face-to-face kind of like environment where you have this exposure, you have this education, you have this learning. And then you have events, which also does the same thing. We have events about entrepreneurship, right? So that helps to sort of, again, do the same things about exposure to entrepreneurs, exposure things. So that's the thread that runs through. The thread that runs through is education, exposure to ideas and thoughts.
Hi, Malek.
Yes. Sorry.
Hi, Malek. Suresh here.
Okay, all right.
Thanks for sharing.
Yep.
I got 2 questions.
Yep.
Question number one is...
very hard. Like radio, we always counsel people to ask 1 question.
Okay.
Because otherwise you answer the second one, don't answer the first one. Okay.
Sure. I do listen to BFM.
Okay.
And I do listen to Light FM, but yep. I'm not 45, okay?
Yep.
All right.
I'm 47, so it's okay.
First one is, for a startup, and for you being very practical that first 2 years, keep your expectation that you can't really generate the revenue straight away, it's not easy to give those kind of benefits or attract good talents, right? So because you're going to compete,
for you to be a startup, to get a good talent to join you, for 2 years not making money is not easy, right? So that's number 1, how do you recruit talent, right? And number 2 is, BFM, one of the unique proposition is, like some of the stuff that you do, like Breakfast Real, are very, very, very strong value to the listener, because you do bring good representative from good companies. So how do you get this kind of partnership for a startup and for a different model?
How do you get this kind of partnership for?
To get this kind of people to join this startup business.
This is radio research. Okay, yeah. All right. Okay, so now I have this 2 question problem again. The first one was, that's what we tell our whole radio presenters, always ask 1 question at a time. 2-part question, very hard. Okay, so let me ask the second part. How do you get people to join in, I guess, when you don't have any when you don't have any money, you know, the 2 years, like that. Right? So what happens? All right, so one, I don't want to be glib about it, but yeah, you need to raise funds, right? So, but what I'm trying to say is the funds that you raise must kind of like, in a way, not just take $50,000 and kind of like, okay, that's it, but you must, and assume that maybe you get money in 6 months' time from revenue, and then you can, so you don't need to ask for 100, you need to only to ask for 50. I think that's the idea. The idea is that you must ask for 100, or you must ask for 150, you must ask for 200, instead of asking just for that thing and depend on the revenue.
So that's the idea. The idea is you do need to raise the money, otherwise you have to give equity away, right? And it's hard to give equity away when you don't know the people. When you try to recruit, you don't know them, you don't know things like that. You know, it's okay if you're part of a gang, right? I mean, Jerry Yang and David Filo and Tim Brady were friends, right? So that's part. But that has its own problems as well, right? So But I know Keegan and Jason, right? Your friends as well, and as well as developers together. So that element comes in. So but if you don't have that, then you need money. You need to raise it, and then you bring people on. But you must assume that you can't get revenues. If you depend on those revenues, you'll be firefighting. That means you can't focus for, you know, after 6 months, you're like focusing on where to get the next revenue. And your clients will ask you to do all kinds of different projects, right? And not your own, right? So you'll be in doubt that. The second part, the values for Breakfast Grill, getting the team involved and things like that. I think specifically for radio, I think radio has a slight advantage, right? It's like if you were to say, I want you to join the mobile industry at Maxis or something. You're interested in the mobile industry, right? You're interested in mobile internet, etc. You join because of the industry. In radio, we have that same thing. People want to join because it's radio, it's broadcast, and we have that benefit. But I think to keep them, to really get the right folks on, you have to have that kind of thing. What do you stand for, right? And your question about, hey, what is, you know, why are you doing radio? Some people are not that interested in radio on BFM team. They're interested in the education part. They're interested in exposing Malaysians to a whole bunch of ideas out there. So those are the guys that come in and join on board. And I'll tell you, our base salary compared to other radio stations is actually not that high. But you know, I treat them like co-owners, right? They get profit sharing, etc. So when we make money, we distribute, right? So they get. Last year they got bonuses at two times in twice last year, right? So to do that, people come on board.
Yo, what's up, sir?
Sorry, there was someone here. Sorry, let me go for you. I skipped past you just now. Yeah, sorry.
Hi everyone. Hi. Thank you so much for sharing today.
Yep.
And more importantly, I want to ask. You brought BFM to where it is today. What is the future for BFM? What's the vision for BFM?
I think that's the same thing. It's the same answer to your question. It's how do we increase, how do we expose people and to Malaysians, really, to ideas and different ways of thinking. So we started something, you know, called Sekilas and Kupas, right, which is a Malay language thing. Try to incorporate the same kind of like, tongue in cheek, you know, laugh at ourselves, laugh at our society, at ourselves. I mean, we're part of it, right? So trying to engage the Malay language community, which I think is, do not have, I mean, have some of these things, but we like to institutionalize it. We really like to push it. So that's what we do, right? So, but again, it's with the same ethos of exposing the Malay language community to something which is to other ideas, some other thoughts, you know. Have we thought about, you know, this? Have you thought about that? Have you thought about the culture of you know, is corruption risky? Is that, is it, or is it haram, right? So all this kind of stuff, right? So that's the Malay community. That's our thing. Maybe if we have if someone were willing to give us a license for a Malay radio station or a Chinese radio station, we'll do things that will follow that ethos. Sorry, one, two. Okay, we'll take two. All right, yeah. You first?
Yeah. Hi, sir. You're what's up? Love Disruptive. Okay, sir. How far do you see the emerging of another BFM? Like, because just now we can see from the slide, BFM is for those 35 years old or blah, blah, blah. So, can we have another BFM for youngest?
Okay. Actually, that was an old slide, 2007. Yeah. But what we're finding, when the data came back, what we found is the age group, 70% of listeners are between 25 to 45. Sorry, 80% of our listeners are between 25 to 45, right? So that slide actually is quite, it's a 2007 slide. And what we found out is that actually that aspiration to learn and to be exposed to new ideas is not limited to the 35 plus segment, right? It's all across, right? So we have even university students listening to us, right? And I'm like, you really do? Yes, we do, right? And like, really? Yes. Like, okay. You know, but who do we? What is the tone that we take? We take the tone that aims at that seasoned manager, right? Who must be in maybe late 30s or 40s, whatever. Our tone of voice is that, but that attracts all kinds of things. You know, like I think there was one time one marketing guy was telling me that Marlboro cigarettes attracted more women, had more women smokers than men smokers, even though it's a cowboy, you know, cowboy man, all that, because it was about independence, etc. So your target language might be to one person, but you might get other groups as well. And I think that's where we're. So do we intend to have a youth station? No, because I think it'll be into that space. But I think what we have, I think we can deal with. They come under our umbrella anyway.
Just now you mentioned that you, in year 2006, you did revisit the idea of a property and car website with JobStreet. So, and I believe this is a really good idea of good business opportunity at that time.
Yeah.
So can you share a bit what lead you not to pursue that business opportunity?
That BFM, idea? The license came through. Ah, shucks, I got a license for a radio station. Can't do that. No, but seriously, it was an either or, right? Because if the license didn't come through, I would need a gig, as they say in Yahoo. You need a gig, and the gig would have been a property site for, and it was aligned with what JobStreet wanted to do, right? But because it was the radio license came through, I said, hey, yeah, fine, I'll do this. So it's sometimes it's just timing, it's luck, right? It's just sequence of events. I'll give you a story about timing and luck. I was down and out. I owed the bank $200,000. In fact, more. I lied. I owed the bank about $300,000, right? In 1997, when and banks were calling me, the Selangor News Vendor Association was knocking on my door, da da da. So all these kinds of things. I never had debt collectors come to my office before. That was my first experience with a debt collector. They must be from Selangor News Vendors Association. They look the same, knuckle dusters and all that. Knock on the table. But interestingly, JobStreet. I remember Mark meeting Mark. Mark said, Malek, don't worry about all this. It's okay. Join me. Don't worry about all that stuff. Join me. I said, Mark, I'm sorry. I can't join you. He wanted to only give me a salary of 6,000 ringgit at the time, which was okay. I mean, it was a startup. 6,000 ringgit was not too bad, right? But I said, I have this $200,000 debt to pay. I lied. I have this $200,000 debt to pay. I said, I can't live on 6,000 and pay the debts as well. Mark actually went back and said, no problem. But then he spoke to other founders of JobStreet. And one of the founders was quite a wealthy guy, old money, we call it, because his family and things like that. This guy never met me one time, and then said to me, Malek, I'll pay off your debt or 200,000 on this condition. Right? I'll give you a check for 200,000 on this condition. If you leave, you must pay me back. If we fire you, it's okay. You don't have to pay me back. Right? But you need to do this and help Mark out. I say, I'm like, wow, that solved my problem, and I joined. So is that timing? Is that luck? That's definitely luck. Who can give you a $200,000 check just like that, right? The only problem was, I should have said the true number, 300,000. Honesty is the best policy, never lie. Anyway, yep. Okay, I think we're, no, so. So there's one hand. Yeah, one. Okay, sure. Can I know you guys? I'm just worried about you guys. That's all, right? I can go on forever, but can we just take? I think this last. If this is second last, I'll take one more, and then we'll call it a day.
Thank you. I would like to share. I'm a social work student, UKM student, and. I'm also doing my business, online business, and now I just done doing my business planning, and I will register my company this October, with SSM.
Yep.
And then I would like to know your opinion, and I'm very familiar about the Blue Ocean, and then I want to know...
Opinion about what, sorry?
Blue Ocean.
Oh, Blue Ocean, okay.
Alright, I'm quite familiar lah.
Yeah.
And then I want to know, I'm planning to build the world center of, because my ambition is social entrepreneur.
Okay.
Because my field social work, and I very passionate about the business.
Alright.
And then I would build my center, like Kenanga World Center, if you all know.
Like what center?
KWC, Kenanga World Center. That's we collect all the product in a rural or IKS or EKS EKS product.
Okay.
In Malaysia.
Yeah.
And then we just I'm
online, as a coordinator. Online or physical?
Physically.
Physically.
Okay. Have a building like KWC.
Okay.
So, sorry, what's the question actually?
Okay, sorry.
I think the question is basically the feasibility, okay. The feasibility of a plan, right?
No, I want to know my conflict lah. Conflict. I'm as a student, final year student of social work.
Yeah.
How I can overcome the perception of other students, because I'm totally student and I'm doing very much overdose lah about the business. So how can I overcome my conflict as a student university lah?
Do you care? I mean, do you care? Do you care what people think?
Yeah.
Right? So I think basically it's about, you know, you obviously have a belief about this venture of yours. You have a belief about it. You want to create a physical place where you can, you know, where you can sell products from rural areas into this place, right? I will ask you one thing. You know, do you need a physical space? Do you need those things? Do you really do? And then, all right, so you say yes. You need to validate that. You need to validate. Test it, right? Do it. Because what's the site? One of you must know sites, right? This is an artisan site that sells art crafted goods all across the world. What's it called? Etsy. That's right. Have you heard of Etsy? ETSY. Have you heard of Etsy? You haven't. Okay. You must do your research. You need to know Etsy. You know Etsy? Okay. But do you know about it? I'm asking you now. Have you heard of Etsy? It's okay if you don't know. It's all right. Have you heard of Etsy? No, you haven't. All right. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is that, I hear this, if you allow me, it's okay. I'll use it as an example, right? Okay, I'll use it as an example. So you have someone here who wants to create an artisanal type marketplace, physical marketplace in Malaysia. And I think she's figuring it out and trying to think about these ideas. But the fact is, I'll use an example because with something like that, someone like that should already be thinking about, okay, do I do a physical one? Do I do an online one? Or do I just park myself at Etsy, right? We need to figure out all these options. I've heard so many entrepreneurs talking about something, but their world, your world, their world, whatever, it needs to be a little bit more worldly. That means you need to look around what is out there. And whether should you do, P1 did what? They did rooms or something, right? I'm not sure you guys remember, P1, the YMAX company, did something called rooms or something, which just tries to do something like Facebook. I'm like, have you seen the world enough, you know? So I think you need to see the world and see, and in a way, your research needs to cover all those kinds of things. And you need to definitively be able to convince an investor that a physical marketplace would work. You know, how would you be different from Kraft Tangan, et cetera, the craft thing in town, and whether your plans is better for the community by just joining Etsy, you know, with your product. Okay, I have one more question. Yeah, last one. Etsy is an online marketplace for artisan goods, right? So that's the beauty about the world. If you're the best in the world for a particular thing, you can get to some of the sites and just become the number one, the number one seller or whatever it is. Yeah. So, yeah. Nah, last question. You have the honor.
Hi. I think it's such a great work that Magic is doing here. So yeah. I'm just wondering whether there are any future plans for BFM to work with Magic and perhaps come up with another station for entrepreneurship, startups. We would love to hear. You just tell us the channel.
Thank you.
Listen, at 10 o'clock, 10 o'clock till 1 is all about startups at BFM. We don't need another one. We don't need competition. I'll be honest with you, right? Organization like Magic, right? To me, the beauty about an organization like Magic is that it's another push from another organization, and so on. Fundamentally, I've never received a government grant before. I've never received any help from government before. Very, very self-reliant. All my money has come from investors, et cetera, because it's so on. So sometimes I have this mixed feelings about, you know, kind of like a government push. You know, I'm a very big believer in, like, you know, if things are meant to happen and if people have the entrepreneurial grit it will happen whether with government funding or without government funding, right? But I've come to the view that, you know what, it's okay. You know, if there's something that's government funded and being government pushed, it's great. It's great for the ecosystem. It's great for entrepreneurs. And if, you know, and if this helps, go for it, right? But fundamentally, I think at the end of the day, if you are a true entrepreneur, right, these things are just things that you learn from. But then what happens is that the true colors come in when you actually start your business. Your true grit comes into it. I've been lucky enough to be on the judge of Entrepreneur of the Year Awards for Ernst & Young, right? I've been doing, the whole weekend, I've been looking at 52 companies. Some of them, their revenues are about 120 million ringgit. They range from 500,000 to about 150 to 200 million ringgit. They are vying for becoming the Entrepreneur of the Year of this. Previous winners are like, you know, okay, Francis Yeo, okay. You know, like, and then you have Shahril Shamsuddin. You have Liu Kisin, who does SP Setia, or was SP Setia. I think got booted out by government. This sort of, when I read those stories, it's a story about grit. Story about that perseverance, that perspiration. The common thing about it all is the perseverance and the thing. There are some of us who are lucky, who managed to be at the right place at the right time. My two classmates, I said, started BillPoint 8 months, you know. 8 months, it sold for about $45 million, right? No, sorry, $125 million, right? And the right place, right time. But you know what? Majority of cases, 99.99% is grit. You know, you have to do it. There's no shortcuts. You are there and so on, right? So you're really doing it, right? So that part. So whatever the government does, great, fantastic. Whatever organizations that come through, and I include MAFCAP, which has been MAFCAP has been a great addition. Magic, I think, will be a great addition, etc. They create opportunities. They create education. Fantastic. But at the end of the day, it's you. And with that, thank you very much. Thanks for staying by for this. Thank you.